resurrect the investigation. But first, they have to prove definitively Alan was murdered.
There's no way we could ever go forward with the case with an accidental drowning. And so we had to go further. We had a new medical examiner. We had to convince him right off the bat that we needed a different determination on that.
The only way to do that is to exhume the body of Alan Brown for a second autopsy. When they do, the findings are nothing short of stunning.
And they found something unique, that there was no water in the stomach. That's just about impossible if you drown. You ever been in that situation, you know you're going to start gulping. There's going to be water in your stomach. Unless you're unconscious the time you're put in that water.
The new medical examiner confirms that the high level of loading alcohol in Alan's system was more than enough to render him unconscious. It all proves conclusively. Alan didn't just fall into the frigid waters of the Flint River. He was dumped there.
That was his conclusion. That this was a homicide.
You just prove what I always been thinking. I know a lot of people wanted me to just leave it alone, quit already. So it was good to see that liquid determination did you.
Now detectives must rewind the clock 20 years to that late afternoon when Alan went missing. The last person to see him alive was his stepmother, Robin, who still lived with Alan's father, Michonne. Rosalind originally said she went to a job interview and left Alan playing with his basketball in the front yard.
I told him to come in and get some food.
When she came home, he was gone. But when Rosalind is brought in by the cold case team, she recalls some curious details about that afternoon. She now says the job interview never happened.
The person she was going to see to be at the interview had left, and so she didn't see him.
Yeah, that's right.
So where was she during that time? Her new story is she went to pick up her mother at work. But when investigators research that one, there's a problem.
Picking up your mother at the factory, but her mother was on sick leave at the time.
Reminded of that fact, Rosalind says she was actually at a bank making a car payment.
She came in on different occasions and we talked to her. And each time we talked to her, we came up with a different story.
I don't know. It's hard to remember.
Even with the passing of nearly two decades, the unraveling threads of Rosalind's memory.
You won't forget something, no. You wouldn't forget everything you did that day. That's a special day. How many times you have a stepson killed? That stays in your mind.
Is Rosalind covering up for someone, or is she herself the killer?
I just couldn't believe that another mother would hurt a child. I didn't want to believe that.
But Rosalind's shifty memory doesn't make her a killer. And there's no evidence to link her or Michonne to Alan's death. She's free to go, pending further investigation. When detectives strategize with Alan's mother about other possible leads, she spots something unusual in the massive case file.
It was just the name on a piece of paper in Alan's office. No last name, no address, no phone number.
Investigation, one interviewee out of hundreds had mentioned a woman named Kathy, who claimed to have information about Alan's disappearance.
She was saying that the little boy was drowned.
It was filed away with all the other false reports and bogus sightings of Alan. Then Detective Parks notices the date of the witness interview. It was conducted several days before Alan's body had been found. At that point, no one knew where Alan was, except the killer. So who is this Kathy, and how did she know?
We're still looking for Kathy, asking her about
this. Detective Clark soon discovers that Kathy is Kathy Marksby, miles away in North Carolina. She could be the key to solving this 20-year-old mystery.
I was really shocked because what she was saying was tying in with everything else that I can find in the investigation.
The witness is Kathy Marksby. At the time, she was married to Montel Pettifer, the brother of Alan's stepmother. They even had a child together. Kathy tells police her husband